Natural history museums everywhere display a lineup of ape-to-human icons that supposedly show how humans evolved from ape-like creatures millions of years ago. Ardipithecus Ramidus, or Ardi, is one of these famous icons, supposedly holding the 4 to 5 million years ago time slot. Ardi is proudly displayed on the front cover of science journals and school textbooks as if paleo experts are certain she holds a place in the evasive ape-to-human progression. But did they find this complete skeleton like shown on the cover of the science journal? Actually, no. This skeleton was reconstructed from over 110 bone pieces they found scattered over a 30-foot area, and it took them over a decade to put it together. This picture is only a digital reconstruction of what they found. What they actually found were bone pieces they said were in terrible condition and literally crumbled when touched. Their lead scientist said Ardi was like roadkill. Let's look at Ardi from head to toe. Her skull was found in 34 pulverized scattered pieces that were compacted down to about 1.5 inches thick. The skull of this tiny ape can fit into the palm of your hand like a softball, and her brain was about the same size as a bonobo or a female chimp's. Evolutionists have actually claimed that Ardi walked upright like humans, partially basing this idea on a few pieces of the base of her skull. But note that they're actually missing most of her foramen magnum, the hole where the spine passes to the skull. They also don't even have the last couple neck vertebrae that would have joined to the skull, relying on even more guesswork. Evolutionists also claim Ardi walked upright because of a supposed human-like curve in her lower spine, called lumbar lordosis. But how much of her lower spine did they find? Well, actually none. So they estimated the curve of her spine based on her pelvis. Dr. Lovejoy believes that her spine was probably long and curved like a human's rather than short and stiff like a chimp's, suggesting that she was an upright walker. You see, we have four curves in our spines to facilitate upright walking, but chimps have only a slight bend over their whole spine, making them better for walking on all fours. Dr. Lovejoy based his belief about Ardi's curved spine on Ardi's reconstructed pelvis and his guess that Ardi had 6 lumbar vertebrae, even when most apes have only 3 or 4, and humans have 5. But think about this. They don't even have any of Ardi's lumbar vertebrae, but this didn't stop them from adding some imaginary ones, giving her a couple extra beyond what typical apes have, inserting an entire imaginary spine, complete with a 4-part curve like humans, and passing it up to the reconstructed base of her skull using imaginary neck vertebrae. Even evolutionary scientists have great concerns about these speculations. In their paper published in Nature Journal, Drs. Wood and Harrison stated, "The claim that Ardi was a facultative terrestrial biped living in trees and also walking upright on the ground is vitiated because it is based on highly speculative inferences about the presence of lumbar lordosis and on relatively few features of the pelvis and foot." So, if they're all basing the belief that she walked upright on her pelvis, what was her pelvis like? Well, for starters, it was too badly broken and fragile to take out of the matrix it was in. So Dr. Lovejoy made a reconstruction based on his knowledge of primate anatomy and a micro CT scanner. After 14 different possible configurations, they settled on this one shown in most reports. Secular paleo experts Drs. Wood and Harrison also expressed a great deal of concern about this, pointing out in a science journal that a whole lot of speculation went into the final pelvis reconstruction. Dr. Jungers even said that choosing the correct pelvis reconstruction was like seeing images in a Rorschach inkblot test and was not convinced of its accuracy. Even Ardi's hands and feet looked ape-like, with really curved long fingers and short thumbs, which are very similar to tree-dwelling apes of today that use them for getting around in trees. Her feet even had a grasping toe hanging off to the side, called a hallux, just like apes have today, so they can use their feet like hands for grabbing branches while moving in trees. Dr. White said that her toe really doesn't differ from apes, and that's the surprising thing. It is fully ape-like. Wouldn't that be awkward, trying to walk on level ground with a big toe sticking out to the side? It sure doesn't add up that she's some early human ancestor. She had a brain the size of a chimp, and a tiny head like a chimp's, with an imagined base of the skull and imagined curved spine. But because of a bump on her pelvis, she was supposedly walking around like a human, with her giant toe sticking out to the side, and her hands were also ape-like. It looks like there's a lot of speculation going on here, and in some cases, even exaggeration. It doesn't look like she'd be a good walker to me, but she'd probably get around in the trees just fine. When you put her next to a bonobo, it sure seems like she fits into the ape family quite well. Is there scientific evidence that supports the Bible's account of human origins? Let's look and find out. One of the most obvious examples that humans are created is found in our hearing system. Taking an honest look at our hearing system reveals an obvious designer. How could random, mindless evolution engineer five separate components that have no purpose unless they are all joined together in a certain order and in a certain way for the purpose of hearing? Even if some random process could put together just one of these five components, it takes engineering and intelligence to join these five parts together so that the sound waves from speech could be heard and then immediately interpreted as communication in our minds. The eye might even be more convincing, containing hundreds of parts that had to be assembled to create the overall purpose and function for seeing. Random chance certainly doesn't have the intelligence needed for assembling different parts into a cohesive, interdependent system for sight to work. Next, let's take a quick tour of some scientific discoveries over just the last few decades that give strong evidence for the Bible's account of human origins. Let's start by looking at DNA, a protein coding language that cannot be replicated by any scientist in the world. It's the most sophisticated information storage system in the known universe. Nothing comes even close. In fact, over 10,000 DNA molecules can fit on the head of a pin, and unfolding just one of them reveals 6 feet of instructions capable of building who you are. Stretching out DNA in the trillions of cells in your body could reach to the sun and back hundreds of times. Perhaps you've heard that humans and chimps share 98% of their DNA, but did you know that when they made this comparison, they ignored 18% of the chimp genome and 25% of the human genome? Plus, the chimp genome is over 6% larger than ours. When they give the 98% similarity figure, it's based on cherry-picked DNA regions that were similar. Of course, humans and chimps have similar DNA. They're mammals living in the world with similar requirements for biological life. Our DNA is also similar to several other creatures. What about DNA research that purportedly shows our genome dates back tens of thousands of years, far outreaching the biblical timeline? Recent research into mitochondrial DNA mutation rates gives the answer. This is unique because it comes only from the mother's egg, making it useful for tracing maternal ancestry. Since DNA was sequenced in 1981, researchers have been studying the mutation rates in mtDNA to try and estimate when different groups of people possibly diverged. Evolutionary researchers have based these timelines on the assumption that humans and chimps shared a common ancestor about 5 million years ago. That date was based on counting the mtDNA and protein differences between all the great apes and timing their divergence using dates from fossils of one great ape's ancestor. This evolutionary assumption counts on the mtDNA mutation rate of about one mutation every 300 to 600 generations, or one every 6,000 to 12,000 years. But do these evolutionary assumptions hold up? Actually, recent studies have shown that the actual mutation rates are much faster than the rates assumed by evolution theory, causing researchers to rethink the mtDNA clock they depend on for forensic investigations. This discovery was published in Nature Genetics by Dr. Parsons and his colleagues, who investigated the mtDNA of 357 individuals from 134 different families representing 327 generational events, which are counted by the number of times that mothers passed on mtDNA to their offspring. Parsons' team showed that mutation rates actually occur at a rate of 1 every 33 generations, which was 20-fold higher than the estimates based on the theoretical 5 million year timeline between chimps and humans that expect about one mutation in every 300 to 600 generations, or one every 6,000 to 12,000 years. This study was published in Nature Genetics, and the faster rate has stood fast even as the number of families in the study has doubled. Other studies have confirmed these findings since Parsons' discovery. For example, Howell's team analyzed mtDNA from 40 members of a family with an overall divergence rate of one mutation every 25 to 40 generations. Howell remarked that both of our studies, his and Parsons', came to a remarkably similar conclusion. Based on these findings, Howell warned that phylogenetic studies, studies that try to estimate the evolutionary branching between animal kinds, have substantially underestimated the rate of mtDNA divergence. As one science writer puts it, evolutionists are most concerned about the effect of a faster mutation rate. For example, researchers have calculated that mitochondrial Eve, the woman whose mtDNA was ancestral to that in all living people, lived 100,000 to 200,000 years ago in Africa. Using the new clock, she would be a mere 6,000 years old. This, of course, fits well within the Bible's timeline. Based on their updated work, identifying 220 soldiers' remains from World War II to the present, Parsons and Holland now have new guidelines, adopted by the FBI as well, to account for a faster mutation rate. Studies have also confirmed that there was a massive DNA variability explosion that happened on Earth just thousands of years ago, within the time frame of Noah's flood and the Babel dispersion that occurred afterwards. Next, let's consider the extent of the fossil evidence that exists for human evolution. Charles Darwin postured that if evolution was true, innumerable transitional forms must have existed. He also questioned, why do we not find them embedded in countless numbers in the crust of the Earth? We agree. If human evolution was true, wouldn't we expect the ground to be filled with numerous transitions between ape-like creatures? We agree with Darwin that the lack of transitions is the most obvious and serious objection which can be urged against the theory of evolution. Even Ian Tattersall, emeritus curator with the American Museum of Natural History, noted that you could fit all the supposed ape-to-human fossil evidence into the back of a pickup truck if you didn't mind how much you jumbled everything up. With centuries of recorded history and over 7 billion interfertile humans on the planet today, we should certainly have more than a truck bed of fossil evidence if evolution was true. The truth is that we are too sophisticated to evolve out of some primordial mud pit over billions of years. We sing, worship, have ceremonies, pray, educate ourselves, and do so many other things that reflect the fact that we are spiritual beings and not animals. God made us on the sixth day of creation to name and take dominion over the entire animal kingdom. This happened just thousands of years ago. God sent His Son to redeem us from the fall that happened when our real forefathers sinned. We have been mercifully brought into a place of grace, forgiveness, and rest if we accept His sacrifice by confessing our sins and surrender our lives to Him. Looking for answers about what the Bible teaches about creation, the fossil record, dinosaurs? Download the Genesis Apologetics app from the iTunes or Google Play stores for answers to these questions and more.